Growing up, I was raised by a single mom. We moved around a lot. I got into using drugs down here, did a lot of drug dealing down here in this neighborhood. My mom worked two jobs. You know, as a young kid, she just tried to put me in basically anything she could.
Karate, then he wanted to do kickboxing, you know, basketball, whatever he wanted to do, you know, he was more than welcome.
You know, everybody told her, your kid's gonna be a champion, so keep him in this, keep him straight, keep him straight. And she's like, I'm trying. I mean, to be realistic, the type of environment I had around me was not good. I mean, I can remember friends there, their moms or parents were addicted to drugs. Around 16 was when I really started digging into the painkillers. Broken fingers, broken toes, broken ribs, those were very common. Just growing up doing martial arts. When they were around, we would take them, you know, Vicodin. That was perfect for me because I could take it and kind of just numb my pain and just keep fighting. I kind of grew up in an age where pharmacies were just starting to kind of be robbed. They just flooded the street, and now you have a powerful prescription painkiller that you're sniffing and you're getting addicted like that.
Would you classify yourself as an addict?
Oh, full blown, yes.
I'm at work all day. How much control do I have over him? I can only tell him, you know, this is what I want you to do, but whether he does it or not is on him.
I was just a 17-year-old kid that just wanted to go. Life was about go. I want to do it my way. I got everything figured out.
I never ever told him, you know, if you don't follow my rules, get out. That was my worst nightmare. That's why I always wanted him with me home.
At the worst, I was full-blown addicted to heroin. My day was only about waking up, making sure either two things. I would have heroin and I would sell it all day long so I could use it, or I wouldn't have heroin and I would do anything the minute I woke up in the morning, if I had slept the night before, to get high that day. There's a lot of my criminal records, which is now all public thanks to Google. 2005 is when I went away. So it was 8.5 years total.
Okay.
And the last sentence was a 5-year sentence, so I had three separate sentences. Growing up, you know, going to jail, it was kind of like a rite of passage, right? I wasn't afraid of it, but you go to the big place, you know, you get classified to a prison that's known for being a real prison. In an instant, you say, yeah, this isn't what I thought it was.
Some distribution of heroin. This was my second sentence for a $10 bag of heroin, and it was a minimum mandatory of 5 years. I ended up doing 2 for it.
At the end of the day, you're stripped of everything you have, everything. You no longer become a person. My family had given up on me for the most part at that point, everybody but my mother.
This was the one I thought I was going away for a long time. My mother got that phone call after violating parole. I was home for 5 days.
5 days.
5 days after being—
I was so disappointed in him.
Released from prison.
Could only make it for 5 days.
I've been in 8, maybe 9 different prisons. I felt like, you know, the old life that I was living at that point wasn't gonna be there in the future. It's either prison for the rest of your life after this or dead. I realized that my life was over at that point if I didn't make a change. So that scared me straight.
I haven't been bench pressing a lot either, but yeah. I usually do this at 225 since I've lost a lot of weight.
I work out from day one. Every time I ever went into jail, I start working out. What am I to do? I'm in a cell 23 hours a day. I'm doing about 1,000 burpees a day, to the point where the guys around me were like, Keith, stop working out. Stop working out all day long. But it's the only thing I could do to cope. When I was able to get my hand on a dumbbell, a barbell, a squat rack, and a jump rope, that's when I really was able to let my mind really expand and to actually get involved in some of the WODs. I
fully went all in. The minute I could get a gym, I grabbed every book I could grab. I grabbed every training journal I could read, I could grab. I asked my mom to sign up for the journal so she could start sending me in the CrossFit journal.
Right, I signed up for the journal, and I think that was the best thing that I could have ever done.
I got What Is Fitness in here, Pursuit of Excellence, Ben Bergeron, 2012.
Of course, I had to get familiar with the terms. I'm like, what's a WOD?
I couldn't wait for the next journal to come. I couldn't wait for the next article to come.
I figured the more information I could get him, you know, the more he would learn.
Level two, level threes, right? Printed those out. So we'd print out the regional workouts when we got them, and I'd try to get them done in a weekend.
So you try to do your own
thing? Oh, yeah. Oh, I do every workout. They can only take so many things from you in prison. What you can control is your fitness, your health, and your mindset. When I started getting back into shape and started doing these really awesome workouts and learning, I started being able to hang in the yard, and I was really respected amongst the peers out there in the yard actually caring about their life. Little did I know I was actually getting my chops coaching, because I was now taking people and teaching them kind of how I train, CrossFit, you know. I would work out with somebody for 5 months, teach them everything I know, they'd go their own way, and then I'd end up with a new group of people, and kind of that's how it circled through for a while.
I gave up sugar. I gave up snacks. I gave up cigarettes. I lost 40 pounds.
I still program for some convicts in the DOC right now. I mean, I get phone calls all the time from guys asking me about stuff. You can control everything that they can't. I can't leave that place, but I can build myself to be better. Instantly, I saw that in CrossFit. The minute I got out, I had already had a plan. The day I came home, I got right on the computer and I found the next certification. The next day, I was signed up at a local affiliate in the town I was living in. From there, I got my level one right away. I had my level one before I had my driver's license. So today we have Lynn. All right, if you've never done Lynn before, Lynn is a pretty classic benchmark, all right? Then I needed a job. I couldn't get a job at Walmart. I couldn't get a job at any of the local places that I applied for because I'm a convicted felon.
Back down, back up is two. We're gonna go to 10, that's gonna help the shoulders warm up.
So it was coaching was the only thing for me then. And 3 years later, I opened a box. CrossFit has set it up for us in such a way that if you do the steps that they give you, you can run an amazing business.
We didn't tell Mike the Nightbird story. No, my interpretation of Stevie Nicks. No, it was,
who's it is Stevie Nicks,
right? Yeah, the song Nightbird. Nightbird. I dubbed it after Sarah, even though it doesn't mean anything what I meant.
It was New Year's Eve. I had plans to go visit a friend and his family. That fell through, so I posted on social media. Looks like my plan fell through, going to the gym or something like that. And I got a message saying, hey, you know, some of us are over here from the box if you wanted to come over.
He was this new guy with tattoos, tall, crushing everybody in workouts. That was the end of the story there. We just, after that, every day together.
I knew right away. So I remember how nervous I was. I had to have my mother drive me to the alcohol store, or the liquor store, I should call it, and buy a bottle of wine because I hadn't had a license yet.
He told me a story right away, everything. And this is literally within probably 4 days.
I was head over heels, and we've been together ever since. I couldn't imagine my life without her. You know, she's such a huge part to my success. Without Sarah, I don't know where Keith would be. Pinch the shoulder blades, good, there we go. Keith the ex-con and Keith the box owner, they're the same person. I've never changed myself completely. I've just grown to the adult and man I am today.
One thing I've always done is stood by him because I knew eventually he was gonna say, okay, enough is enough. You know, I gotta grow up.
Keith's passion for CrossFit and for what it's done for him kind of drew out my passion to bring it to other people.
There was a point in my life I didn't think I was going to be able to do anything. All I could do was daydream. And in my daydreams, the perfect looking daydream
was literally the equivalent of my life today. This is where I come from. This wasn't the end of my road. And, you know, I'm glad to give anything I can away.